So in the first section, you had a brief introduction to cellular automata. There's a lot more to say about it, but I at least got a chance to give you a taste for the different kinds of patterns that each of the different kinds of rules can produce, and I even gave you a little bit of a sense of the magic of rule 110. And 110 will come back a little bit later. For now, though, what I'm going to talk about is how we can think about coarse-graining a cellular automata. And when we go from the Markov chains of the previous section to the cellular automata here, there's going to be one important change, and that change is going to affect how we think about the renormalization process. So if we go back to the finite state machines, to the Markov chain models, if you have a system that you observe every, let's say, 1 second time step, and then you decimate that system down, you coarse grain it, and so you now observe the system every 2 time steps. The original model, in order to get from t plus 1 to t plus 2, you needed to know your position among the n states. You needed to know which state you were in. And once you knew which state you were in, you could figure out which state you were in at time t plus 2. And similarly, to go from time t to t plus 1, you just had to know which state you were in at time t. It's a Markov chain, and so what that means is that you have a finite and fixed number of states over time. When we came to coarse grain that model, we could still keep the same relationship. In order to know where you were at time t plus 2, all you had to do was know your position among all of the n states of the new updated model at time t. What that meant was that we stayed within the same model class when we dropped some of the time information. We could produce a n state Markov chain that skipped every step if we had an n state Markov chain at the finer grained time scale. This changes completely when we come to the cellular automata. So if we take that grid evolution algorithm that we introduced you to, what you saw was that to know what the state of the system here is at time t plus 1, you needed to know the state of these three grid squares just above it. And then to know the state of that point at time t plus 2, again, you only needed three pieces of information. But imagine that we dropped, we coarse-grained, we decimated out the t plus 1 data. What do you have to know about this, or what do you have to know about the state of the system here to know the value of this point here? And as Ian Classy, one of the people I learned this technique from, once said, this is sort of like what a physicist would call a light cone, because as you go further back in time, in order to know the state of this point here, you have to know the state of this point here. But in order to know the state of this point here, you have to know the state of the system at these three points here. And similarly, to know the state of the system at this point here, you have to know the state of the system here and here as well. And so as you go further and further back in time, as you drop this chunk of data here, if you were to naively try to do the same trick we did with the Markov chain, which is just come up with a model that worked just as well to go from t to t plus 2, you would find that instead of having a rule that looked like f of x, y, and z, your rule would now have to include a, b, c, d, and e. You'd have to, in fact, have 5 inputs to your function. When you coarse grain a cellular automata only along the time dimension, you no longer stay within the same model class. If you said, okay, produce a model that can get you from here to here, that model would not fall in one of the 256 coarse grain, or one of the 256 cellular automata that we introduced you to in the first section of this module. So, what do we do? Well, this is a trick that was introduced by a pair of scientists, Israeli and Goldenfeld, and then I learned how to make it work in person from Ian Classy and Josh Grochow here at the Santa Fe Institute. But here's one story about how to solve this problem. If you coarse grain in time, you don't stay within the same model class. Well, what Nigel and his collaborators did, what Goldenfeld and Israeli did, was ask you to think not about individual grid points at this later time point, but pairs of grid points. And then to look, of course, at the backwards light cone, the space of influence that this pair is subject to. So one step back, it's pretty easy. I just have to add one more point here. So this is the set of grid points that I have to know in order to predict the state of this pair of grid points at time t plus 2. And then if I zoom one step further back, what you can see is that I just have to include an additional grid point here on the far left edge. So these two grid points at time t plus 2 are influenced by all of these six grid points at time t. What Goldenfeld and Israeli then asked us to do was to consider this supercell here as a unit. Call this, let's say, a hat. And these six cells here, to group them into three supercell units, x hat, y hat, and z hat. If you write it this way, then the logic of the fine-grained simulation means that, in fact, the state of the A hat grid cell is now equal to something, we'll call it F hat, X hat, Y hat, and Z hat. So the state of this pair here, whether they're both on, this one's on and this one's off and this one's on, or they're both on, that state of that grid cell or that supercell here depends upon the state of these three supercells up here. And this law here is given in the same form as this law here, with one change. The original evolution law for the cellular automata takes binary variables, ones and zeros. This evolution law here takes pairs of ones and zeros. Instead of there being two possible states for each supercell, there are four. And while this one here outputs a 1 or a 0, this function here outputs a 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. So we're part of the way there to coarse-graining the cellular automata. But we're only part of the way. We have something that depends, we have a function that depends upon three arguments and spits out one. That's an improvement over what we wanted to do before, where we had a function that takes in five arguments. The problem is that these arguments are now no longer binary variables. So what do we do? Well, instead of coarse graining just in time, we can also coarse grain in space. And what they introduced was a projection operator P. And so what P does is it takes a supercell, it takes the state of a supercell, and maps it to a binary variable 0 or 1. So explicitly, there are four possible states the supercell can be in. And what the projection operator does is it maps some of them to, let's say, the one state, and it maps the rest of them to the zero state. You can think of this projection operator here as something very similar to what we did at the introduction to this module altogether, where I showed you how you could coarse grain an image, in that case, the image of Alice and Dinah, her kitten. In this case here, for example, we could imagine doing a spatial decimation where we take only the value of the first entry in the supercell. That kind of spatial decimation would lead to a projection operator where both of these terms were mapped to zero and both of these terms were mapped to one.